they go and use you. Says that the disciples were about their daily duties, The mother said that they went back to the former things. Paul said, how can I deny such greater salvation? They just see the man go down. They know the man rise. They come, they see the wounds. But yet still, they were doing the carnal things that they are accustomed doing because they believe they were fishermen. Open all the following. Sometimes when God comes to us in our life and God starts to work mysteries, we get caught up because we're not sure it's God. You ever feel like that? I ain't so sure. It must be a spirit. It must be a person. It must be something I did. It must be something I yet to do. Maybe something my ancestors did. I don't know. But I want to declare that it is just the Lord. The scripture says that while I was yet a sinner,
Christ
died for me. So it doesn't matter what you do. It don't matter what you say, who you believe you are or not. God is still God in your situation.
Hallelujah.
So these men, they're working for Jesus in a kind of way. They go down on the sea and Peter says, you know, I'm going to fish because I'm hungry. And the carnal man always put the physical things before the spiritual things. Yeah. Even though Jesus said, I came and I will give you life and give it to you more abundantly, they were still caught up with the physical food, with the bread, and with the water, with the wine, with the raiment, with the shelter, with all the things that we caught up with every day. So they caught up. And they go on the sea. And he started to call the same people that was with him. When he first got called, he called all of them again. So it's a group. It's a troop. And they move in together. And oftentimes, brethren in the church and in our lives, we move in a group. You know about that? We move in a troop. And the troop have a ringleader. And if the ringleader don't understand about God, oh Lord, we launching out into the deep because the ringleader don't understand and we haven't took time yet to understand God. Well, you know about that? It has happened. That is why the ministers ought to study to show themselves approved unto God so that they can what? Lead the people in the right way. But that is not what we're talking about. So they're in the boat. And the scripture says that they were there all night. And they caught nothing. How many of us have toiled all year and caught nothing?
Oh, yes.
How many of us toil, maybe in a job, 15 years, and we still waiting on promotion? We ain't catch nothing. How many of us toiling in a marriage, 20 years? And we still ain't getting nothing, we ain't happy yet. We talk about toiling in the boat, you know. This here Tiberias is the sea of life. Yeah? That's the rocky place, the salty place. When the wind blows and the waves get big, it's so deep that they have plenty of fish. And the fish have so much space they could go where they want. So you can't just cast in it anywhere and catch. You're gonna be a skillful fisherman. We're on the sea of life. And we are casting our net in the water and we ain't catching nothing. I want to tell you, this is not the first time that that happened to these people. If you search the scripture, we'll see in the book of Luke chapter 5 that they were underwater for a whole night when Jesus first met them and they catch nothing. So after 3 years of being with the Savior, they still don't have the skill to catch. Can you imagine this thing? We talk about knowing God, you know. Moses left with the people, and after spending all that time crossing over and seeing all the miracles of God, he said a pillar of fire by night, the cloud to cover them by day. The skill wasn't skillful when he went up. They decided to do something else. God just bless you. You now get the blessing. Yes. And as you walk out the church with the blessing, you throw away the blessing. That's a lack of skill in catching. You see, when the scripture uses the word catch, you know when we say catch, it true, it just, it don't mean take it and catch means to hold on to it. If you translate the word literally, Jesus asked him, did you hold on to anything? Knowing the Lord. Brethren, what have you held on to?
My Lord.
What in your net? We talk about knowing God. What is in your net? Sometimes the things we put in our nets, although they may be big and heavy, they are worth nothing. Well, you know about that? The people we place our faith in, although they may be high and mighty, yet still are they nothing. The things that we trust in and hold on to, though they may seem to be comfortable to us, they are nothing. Hear what Jesus says. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all good things will be added unto you. So these people on the boat, they didn't catch nothing. And Jesus now wants to manifest who he is, what he is, how he is, how he make up. To these people, he tell them, listen, question, you catch anything yet? He starts to challenge the people. You see, God is challenging us to mold our life like his, that we ought to cast our net and catch. When we ask, we should receive. When we seek, we should find. When we knock, the door shall be open unto us. That's molding your life in a Christ-like character. Because everything Jesus asks for, he gets. True? But he says one thing. Lord, if it be thy will, let this cup pass. That's the thing he asked for that he couldn't get. Because the cup. You see, when they read it, So when you see you're molding your life in a Christian way, it means that what you speak, so it is. You understand what I'm saying? So when Jesus asks him a question, Jesus don't ask you a question without giving you a commandment. If we search the scripture, the first five books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and Acts, we see that whenever Jesus asks a question, he follows up with an action point for you to do. Brethren, so they are there examining the net. There's no fish. They're in despair. They went all night. They toiled hard. They have no food to eat. They have no place to live. They have no income. They have no savior. They don't have nothing. The Romans running them down. The Jews trying to kill them. Oh God, they can't go in the synagogue. They can't go in the temple. They can't go in the village. They just by the sea in the wilderness. And they have nothing. When God ready to know you, God has put you in the wilderness.
My Lord. Hallelujah.
I say when you're ready to know God, you know. When God ready to know you, because if you search a scripture in the book of Exodus, God said, Moses, I know you by name. Yes. Moses didn't tell God, I know you, God. God tell Moses, I know. That means that God tried the man. He looked inside the man. He did him up and he understood the man for what he was, and he put something that he could use in that man, pull it out. That's when God told you. I knew it was the Lord, but I want God to know me. I want to turn it around, because the scripture talk about that. So Jesus followed up with the commandments. I want to read it exactly as he says it. Cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. He ain't put on a whole long road with them.
Simple.
He said, listen, sometimes when you're on a boat of life, you're going to take up yourself from what you know and cast down what you don't know in order to understand who you are to get to what you're supposed to know. Cast your net on the other side, and not just any side. He said, put it on the right side, because I, the Lord, am about to be seated at the what? Right hand of my Father. Not on the wrong side, that's the left side. This the R, Didi. He just get so. He just pull back so.
He said, put your net on the side for me to give you something.
And here we can get them with the commandment. Jesus gives a promise.
If you think you know God, and they get a commandment from God, and you didn't get no promise from God, something wrong.
Cast your net on the other side. And here Jesus said, and ye shall find.
No matter how long you leave that net, or how short you leave that net, if you're coming the first hour, if you're coming in the ninth hour, if you're coming in the 12th hour, if you're coming at the 23rd hour of that day, if you cast your net, you must find it.
Amen.
How will you understand what Jesus is doing? When he's showing himself that we should know who he is.
He's a kind of God that when he tells you something, he means it. He's not like the other types of gods. The other types of gods is when they're giving you, they give you a little bit to keep you coming back for more. You understand? When the God in your home giving you, it giving you a little bit, so it keep you on the gravy train. So you're always coming back to get the nectar. Or that's how I say it. When the boss giving you, he giving you a little bit. So that you could stay there subservient. If you get everything, you know what we're going to do? We'll go. But Jesus is not like that. He absolutes. He said that if you believe on me, you shall not die. See, get everything there. You understand that? He didn't portion it up. And if you work today, you'll get something, and you work tomorrow, you'll get something. Not at all.
Full promise.
When we begin to labor for the Lord, he gives us the command, and then he puts a promise in our heart what he's going to do for us. And we must believe that promise to be true.
If you know God, you will know that he is not a man, and he is slack on his promises. So they start to throw the net. They do some work. They exhausted now, because whole night they go in. But they had to bend down, and they had to pull up the net. Sometimes you gotta get by this, pull up the net. Pull up the net.
And when they get to that point of exhaustion, they can't go no more. They just lift it up and cast it over. It falls into that deep. It falls into that deep. And automatically, magically, extra supernaturally, the net suddenly gets full up with fish.
Yes, man.
While the net full in, the disciple whom Jesus loved, we call him John the Beloved.
Yeah, that's the last one to go. That one.
Who leaned his head on Jesus' side. Look at that, a mystery in that. When Peter and them fellas was quarreling and quibbling about who going to receive you, Lord, how you're going to go, Lord, why are you doing this, Lord? All he did, he leaned his head on Jesus' side. Head to head, the head go on the breast, and he started to listen to the man's heartbeat. In that hour, he started to commune with God, while the other disciples was just there, you know, quarreling, in confusion, in desperation. Then he leaned his head, and he started to say, Lord, Lord,
Lord,
Lord. And we're talking about knowing God. When you start to know God, you're gonna lean on God. You're gonna sink into God. You're gonna get down in God. You can't lean to your own understanding. You've got to lean on Jesus' side. So you man get in. And because John was leaning on his side, he could have said, hey, all your fellas, there is the Lord. You see, the sheep must know the shepherd's voice. And although his voice may have changed now, because the Christ of God is no longer flesh, he is spirit. So he had to kind of come down a little bit to manifest himself before the people. Because those that worship me must worship me in spirit and in truth. Those who know me got to know me in what? Spirit and in truth. This man point out, and immediately, without delay, Peter realized at that moment When they say, look, Jesus there, the man realized he was naked. He didn't have no clothes. He wasn't covering himself in prayer. No, he didn't cover himself in the blood of Jesus. He didn't cover himself in the promise. He didn't cover himself in the labors of the Lord. He just was there. Naked as he come into the world. That means he didn't get nothing on him. All that Jesus preached didn't drop on him yet. Sometimes you're preaching 10 years in the church and it didn't drop on the members yet. Sometimes, oh God, your children, and it ain't dropping on them yet. But all I want to tell you is continue. Because it's going to drop at some point. Somebody's going to say, it is the Lord. And when he starts to knock at the door, Peter had said again in conviction, he got conscience at the bottom of him, he died into the water. He didn't care if he drowned. He didn't care if a whale come. He didn't even know it was shark in the water. Jellyfish to sting him. He just dived down in the water and he head for the shore. Because when he fixed his eyes upon the Creator, he started to move in the spirit towards the Creator. When you're moving before God, you're going to move in the spirit. The deep things are the mysteries of God. A mystery from God could be, sit up when they get up in the morning, put 3 drops of water in front of your house, and I don't back this thing, right? That's a mystery from God. But, you know, you just there and thinking, 3 drops of water, oh God, that ain't nothing. That not, I see more than that on YouTube, right? I see them doing so much of things there, that can't do nothing. You see, the mystery of the Lord is with them that fear him. Knowing God, fearing God. Peter going down. The other disciples, they delayed their meeting Jesus. Because although they noticed the Lord, they say, listen, this man can catch fish. So we have to bring this fish. Not everybody can dive down the same time. Some people take a little longer while they're gathering themselves together in the boat of life. But that is okay. They go to the shore. But here, key. When they reached the shore, fire was already there.
Yes.
Fish was already there. Bread was already there. So they had no need to catch the fish because Jesus had already provided it. But he wanted to show them something. I am the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Are you understand that?
Yes.
Before you reach the place to receive it, God has already provided it. When you know in God, you know about them things. Oh, I want to understand the concept of Jesus. It's an all-providing, absolute, never-ending love. He loved them so much, he do the work, and he prepare the things for them. The scripture goes on to say that they drew their nets. And their net was full of fish, but it qualified the word fish with large fish. So now you're going to the market, you're going to buy some sprats, you're leaving the big kingfish because it's $50 a pound, and you can't afford the whole thing, right? And unless they slice it and give you a slice, you don't want it. So you're circumscribe, you constrict how much you're going to consume. You understand? In the carnal. But in the spiritual world, it's a large fish. They have no constriction with God. Huh? Oh, you understand what I'm saying? He didn't allow them to catch thin flat fish and then flat fish with plenty bone, we don't like it. No, he didn't get big fish full of flesh, full of juice, full of nourishment for their soul. So that the net was heavy. And the disciples started studying the head about the size of the net, the size of the catch, so that the writer writes that the net did not break. I don't know if we understand about knowing God. When we start to know God, our net, what we just use to catch. Some people have a basket, some people get a calabash, some people get a tarry, I don't know. But the net, when we start to walk God work and walk God work and talk God talk, Don't matter how much he full it, it can't break.
Amen. Lord. Hallelujah.
Don't matter how much God pour in you, it can't break. Don't matter what trial and tribulation he carry you through, it can't break. Don't matter how much blessing he give you, you still have more blessings again. That's God. Huh? The abundant God of creation. He said, listen, I came to give you life, and I didn't come to give you stingy. I come to give you more abundantly.
Praise him. Praise him.
Hey, the fish. The big fish. Brethren, I wonder if you ever search a scripture about fish.
You know, we just keep Thanksgiving and put two nice red fish on the table somewhere and fry the fish. And everybody want a piece of that fish, right?
Yeah.
But it's nice, it looks good.
Tell me about the fish.
Let me start to get into the fish today. Revival will carry on till next week.
So we ain't going there.
Yeah.
But the bishop said that even though you're dumb in Babylon, increase. The Spirit of God put that in your mouth. Because when we start to talk about the meaning of the word fish in Hebrew, we're talking about a multiplier to increase. Yeah. I didn't tell you that, you know, the Spirit just tied it in nice there. For us to understand, and when he tell them, fill up that net with fish, he was saying, go forth, preach the word, and multiply the word in the hearts of man.
Oh, yes.
He's talking about laying the cornerstone, the foundation that he will build his church. Peter, upon this rock, will I build my church, and the gates of hell, the Sea of Tiberias, cannot prevail against you. Though the sea is empty, I, Jesus, going to fill it for you. Multiplication in the spirit. Hi. When we start to talk about fish in the net, brethren, we started getting to why it had 153 fish. When we start to go down into that piece of scripture, we start to understand the meaning of the word.
Oh God.
There is a name. We just call the name all the time. 153 times it was written in the Old Testament up to the book of Malachi. You understand the kind of God we serve in? This man called Jesus tying what was before with what is and in what is to come, you know. The man know what was in the past. He know what is in the future. I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. That is a plan to increase you. A plan to bless you. A plan to make you better than what you are. I know what I have in store for you. You just gotta hold on.
Yes.
Just hold on.
Oh yes.
Let me show you the kind of God. Someone knowing God. Joseph carrying his brethren down into Egypt, and they were numbering a few number. 12 brothers, father, mother, children, wives, whatever. When they came out of the land of Goshen, they numbered over 1 million people strong.
Increase.
Huh? You understand what I'm talking about? Increase? They come from 12 small tribes to a people that could have subdued a whole land from the land of Goshen all the way up the plains to the edge of the river Tiberias and the edge of the Euphrates, and they're expanding, and they're and even up to today, expanding power. When you start to know God, you start to expand your boundaries. If it was on this tile, you got to move from that tile and tile it out. They call that the square and the compass. You got to know how to multiply your grace in your life through the things that you are doing, through the people that you have around you, through the words that you say, through the actions that you take, through the type of life that you live. Knowing God. Multiplication power of the master. Fish.
Knowing
God. And Jesus says unto them, only three things is that let me know. Come and die. I know we love that.
Come and die.
So I want to talk about command line. That's a whole gospel by itself. But the key is that the disciples did not even bother to ask him who he was at that point. They knew who he was. And if we compare it to the first time he did this, that's in the book of Luke. You know, when he tell the man the first time, Peter was a bit hesitant. Just like we just get hesitant when God started to talk to us. We want to wait a little bit, you know. I had to hear it 3 times first. Not a Baptist thing, right? I got to get confirmation 3 times before I go to Lord. Woo! Jesus. Yeah? And the 3 times will become 7 times. And then we say 7 wasn't the number, 9 is the number. And then 9 become 12 times because 12 is a holy number. Oh, God. Peter was hesitant. If you're still hesitating to worship God and to love God and to manifest godliness in your life, my word to you is stop being hesitant and come and dine. Now when we get on the word of the wheel of the word and the word of the wheel is life and the word is life. So you know it sounds strange, eh? But I know what I say. It is a wonderful thing. It's a beautiful thing for us to be partakers of the heavenly gift. I want to say that to know God is to love God. And when God knows you, God loves you with a special love. He said unto Abraham, you know, I kind of love you with a special love, not a regular love for the human being, you know. He said, you know, Abraham, I'm going to call you and I'm going to bless you. But all the generations after you will have the same blessing of you because of you. So when you start to know God, everything that come out from you, as long as it come out from your lineage, it bless. I want to only bless the lineages that coming out. Yeah? That's where it starts. Because when you start to order your steps before God, God starts to change your DNA, you know? He's going to change your makeup. Your heart don't be the same. Your liver don't be the same. Your gut don't be the same. Your stomach don't be the same. The things you could digest when it was in the world, you can't digest it when you're in God. You start to change up. And anything coming out of you, coming out with that change. When I say change your clothes, hallelujah.
Change.
So we want to give God thanks and praise because of what he has done, because of who he is, because today we heard of how Jesus manifested himself to the apostles and how they, at the end of it, only at the end, eh? Not all the way through, you know. You just only know in the end. Yes? Those who older me can tell the younger ones.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's only not the mystery of God in the end. When you look back and you survey the land and you see this is what the Lord has done, you say, I know it was. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So we want to bless your heart today. Because God is God.
All by himself.
All by himself. Yes? Love that statement. All by himself.
All by himself.
We're going to stand and worship God. Because when the words fall on the ground,
come on,
you know, you had to water it.
Yeah. Yes.
If you didn't water it, the seed can't spring out.
Yeah.
And then the process can't happen. He just doesn't know about them things, you know. I'm from the old school, right? I'm from them days. I'm looking young, right? I'm from them days. I hear right here in this church in those days. Hallelujah.
Yes.
So, what did I feel? So that the word will take roots. And remember, and when you know God, you're going to believe and trust on the promises of God. when I get down.
When I get down.
Yes, I'm feeling good.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.